Multibangun Rekatama Patria adalah perusahaan nasional yang bergerak di bidang industri geosintetik. Sejak didirikan pada tahun 1998, perusahaan ini telah menangani ratusan proyek yang tersebar di seluruh Indonesia. Dengan pengalaman yang dimiliki, menjadikan PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria dipercaya menangani proyek-proyek dari perusahaan multinasional milik pemerintah dan swasta. PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria selalu menjaga kualitas material dan pekerjaan dengan didukung oleh tim yang kompeten dan berpengalaman di bidangnya. Visi PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria adalah menjadi pemimpin pasar dalam industri geosintetik di Indonesia yang selalu bersaing dengan sehat. Misi PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria adalah menjalankan kegiatan perusahaan dengan standar etika yang tinggi dan bermartabat disertai dengan kejujuran dan integritas. Meningkatkan kesadaran pengguna produk geosintetik untuk memilih produk dan solusi yang tepat atas masalah proyek yang dihadapi. Menjual dan melakukan pemasangan produk-produk geosintetik yang berorientasi pada kepuasan pelanggan dengan memberikan pelayanan berupa material berkualitas dan jasa pemasangan oleh tenaga-tenaga ahli dan berpengalaman. Mengembangkan perusahaan dengan sumber daya yang modern dan profesional. Memberikan penghargaan kepada karyawan melalui kesejahteraan yang baik, penyediaan lingkungan kerja yang aman dan nyaman, serta kesempatan untuk mengembangkan karir. Produk-produk PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria. Produk Tensar System terdiri dari GeoGrid Tri-X. Terbuat dari bahan polipropilen berkualitas yang berfungsi sebagai stabilitas tanah dasar, khususnya pada tanah lunak. Multi-block retaining wall system. Multi-block retaining wall system merupakan sistem konstruksi dinding penahan tanah segmental, perpaduan antara modular block beton sebagai facing dan tensar uniaxial geogrid sebagai perkuatan tanah. Geomembran. Geomembran terbuat dari polimer plastik yang bersifat kedap terhadap cairan. Kami juga menyediakan produk-produk geosintetik lainnya seperti geotekstil, material drainase, serta geosintetik clay liner yang menjadi solusi bagi proyek-proyek Anda. Gudang PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria hanya 5 menit dari gerbang tol Bitung Tangerang, sehingga memudahkan akses pengiriman material. Gudang PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria terletak di kawasan pergudangan pengembangan kawasan terpadu 2, Bitung Tangerang. Yang mempunyai luas 3.300 meter persegi, dapat menampung material geosintetik dengan pengaturan dan penyusunan material yang tertata rapi. Serta pengoperasian alat dengan tenaga profesional. dipastikan material geosintetik tak terjaga kualitasnya. Hingga sampai di lokasi proyek. Selalu ready stock dan pelayanan profesional adalah komitmen kami. Dengan pengalaman dan pelayanan yang teruji, maka jangan ragu untuk menghubungi kami. Kunjungi website kami di www.multibangunpatria.com.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi, salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Pada hadirin sekalian, perkenalkan saya Astri yang akan membawakan acara webinar pada pagi hari ini. Saya ucapkan selamat datang di acara MRP Webinar Series yang terakhir di tahun 2022. Dengan tema Site Investigation Technique for the Design of Embankment Build over Subplay pada pagi hari ini, 15 Desember 2022. Webinar ini dipersembahkan oleh PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria Geosynthetic Specialist. Sebelum memulai acara, perkenalkan saya membacakan susunan acara webinar pagi kali ini. Pertama, akan dibacakan tata tertib dan tata cara dalam webinar kami. Kedua, sambutan oleh Bapak Antonius Bagus Wijaya selaku perwakilan dari PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria. Acara kemudian dilanjutkan dengan paparan oleh Bapak Michael Dobby, lalu dilanjutkan dengan sesi tanya-jawab. Sebelum mengakhiri acara, saya juga sudah menyampaikan kuis berhadiah uang untuk 3 orang pemenang dan kalender eksklusif dari PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria. Maka dari itu, peserta dimohon untuk tidak langsung meninggalkan webinar setelah paparan berakhir. Informasi terkait sertifikat dan lainnya akan diumumkan di akhir acara. Demi kenyamanan bersama, saya akan bacakan terlebih dahulu tata tertib webinar pada pagi hari ini. Presentasi oleh pembicara akan dibawakan dalam bahasa Inggris. Apabila Anda memiliki pertanyaan untuk pembicara, dapat langsung diketikkan dari sekarang dan selama presentasi berlangsung melalui fitur Q&A yang terletak di bawah layar Anda. Pertanyaan lebih baik jika disampaikan dalam bahasa Inggris. Webinar kali ini juga disiarkan secara langsung di channel YouTube kami, yaitu Multibangun Rekatama Patria, atau di link bit.ly/livemrpwebinar-2022, atau yang kami share pada kolom chat. Kami tidak menyediakan link absen maupun presensi. Untuk mempersingkat waktu, saya persilahkan Bapak Antonius Bagus Wijaya, selaku perwakilan dari PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria, untuk memberikan sambutan. Pada Bapak Antonius Bagus Wijaya, dipersilahkan.
Selamat pagi, Bapak, Ibu, dan Saudara-saudari sekalian. Kami ucapkan terima kasih atas kehadirannya di acara webinar Zoom kali ini. Pertama, mari kita ucapkan syukur puji kepada Tuhan Yang Maha Esa atas berkat karunia-Nya karena kita semua bisa berkumpul di acara ini. Perkenalkan, saya Bagus Wijaya mewakili PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria, perusahaan yang sudah berpengalaman sebagai geosintetik spesialis lebih dari 20 tahun dalam suplai dan pemasangan produk-produk geosintetik, seperti tensor geogrid yang terdiri dari geogrid biaksial, geogrid tri-ax, geogrid uniaksial, serta multi-block retaining wall system dan sierrascape retaining wall system. Ada juga produk geosintetik lainnya seperti Witex geomembran, geotextile, dan geosintetik untuk drainase. Acara ini kami selenggarakan sebagai bagian dari dedikasi kami di bidang teknik sipil pada umumnya dan juga bidang geosintetik pada khususnya untuk memajukan pembangunan di Indonesia. Kami senang mengetahui bahwa MRP Webinar Series dapat menangkap animo dan antusiasme dari para penggiat teknik sipil dan ilmu terkait. Tahun ini, kami bangga dapat melaporkan bahwa selain dua sesi MRP Webinar Series, kami juga telah sukses menyelenggarakan dua sesi workshop tatap muka atau offline pada bulan Juli dan September 2022 yang membahas penggunaan software TensorSoil. Kedepannya, kami berharap MRP dapat selalu menjadi acuan dan pusat penyebaran keilmuan teknik sipil, khususnya geoteknik dan terkait geosintetik bagi Bapak-Ibu hadirin sekalian. Terima kasih atas antusiasme dan dukungannya selama ini. Tanpa berlama-lama lagi, kami ucapkan selamat mengikuti webinar ini. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih kepada Bapak Antonius Bagus Wijaya atas sambutannya. Selanjutnya, webinar pada pagi hari ini yang bertemakan Site Investigation Technique for the Design of Embankment Built over Soft Clay akan dibawakan oleh Bapak Michael Dobby, yang merupakan Regional Manager Asia Pacific of Tensar. Sebelum beralih ke Bapak Michael Dobby, saya akan membacakan CV beliau. Bapak Michael Dobby telah menempuh kualifikasi akademiknya pada tahun 1973 di University of Bristol dengan gelar sarjana Bachelor of Science Civil Engineering, lalu melanjutkan di Imperial College London pada tahun 1977, dan berhasil meraih gelar Master of Science in Soil Mechanics under Professor Bishop. Beliau mendapatkan gelar Professional Chartered Engineering di UK pada tahun 1978. Dan merupakan seorang fellow ICE di tahun 2011. Beliau juga mendapatkan Chartered Institution of Highway dan Transportation pada tahun 1992. Pada Bapak Michael Dobby memiliki pengalaman lebih dari 40 tahun di bidang geotechnical engineering di Inggris maupun di luar negeri, terutama berhubungan dengan jalan raya, perumahan, jembatan, dan dermaga. Baiklah, sekali lagi saya ingatkan kepada hadirin semua yang memiliki pertanyaan untuk Bapak Michael Dobby, bisa langsung menggunakan fitur Q&A yang terletak di bawah layar Anda. Pertanyaan dapat disampaikan dalam bahasa Indonesia, namun akan lebih baik dalam bahasa Inggris. Tanpa memperpanjang waktu, kepada Bapak Michael Dobby, dipersilahkan.
Well, good morning, everybody. I hope you can now see my screen. And my first job is to thank you all very much for attending our webinar today. It's a topic which I think is of great importance, and that really is partly why I felt it was worth creating a particular presentation about this subject of site investigation of soft clays. It can be related to embankment design and other situations as well. Now, thank you all for attending. And just to mention that this is the 13th in a series of webinars arranged by PETE Multibangun Rikatama Patria. And I would always like to thank them very much for their incredibly good work in creating these events. They do a very professional job of doing this, and I hope you find that this comes across to you very clearly, because as ever, we are now relying very much on the internet to do this. So today we're going to look at site investigation of soft clays to support embankments of various types, but it could be, as I mentioned, for other applications as well. And then at the end, I want to talk about performance of a trial embankment, which became the subject of a settlement prediction competition. So there's a wide range of information I want to present today. And as usual in these webinars, I have these little blue boxes that will sometimes appear providing some additional information or possibly asking a few questions as well. This is the full series of webinars that have been organized by Peter Multibangun, and I've just been lucky to be able to present them. And as I mentioned before, all the hard work is done by my colleagues here. The topics have been a variety of things on geotechnical matters. Obviously, some of them are related directly to geosynthetics, and some of them are more general, but all geotechnical engineering needs to be taken into account when we use geosynthetic materials in various forms of structure. So this topic in December 2022 is all about site investigation of soft clays. I should just mention that looking at this list here, there are two of them now in blue color, which are very closely related. There is a little bit of repetition of some of that information, but they also do complement what I want to talk about today. Now, I think the content is going to go a little bit over an hour. I don't think I can fit everything inside 1 hour. So I will be as quick as I can when I can, but there are some points where I want to slow down slightly and make explanations which perhaps are a bit more thorough. But let's see how we get on. So there'll be an introduction. I want to talk about the marine clay profile. Then a few words about planning investigation of soft clay sites. That doesn't use the word site investigation, because investigation can go beyond just the site itself. We can do desk studies. We can find general information as well about these materials. But I then want to move on to looking at the physical and index properties that we normally measure for these materials. Then a few words about shear strength and compressibility, both of course, great importance to this. And then I want to concentrate on a particular topic, which is sensitivity of the calculated settlement to assumptions and parameters used. When you're planning a site investigation and when you're interpreting the data, it's very important to be aware of the effects of assumptions that you might make and also the parameters that you measure. And the idea is to see what happens to the calculated settlement of an embankment depending on a number of possible ways you could approach it. So as I mentioned earlier, some of the content has been presented in previous MRP webinars, but the majority is new. Just to mention that won't quite finish everything, because I also want to talk about a particular trial embankment that was built in Malaysia a long time ago, which is a fascinating case of its own. And the content I have and that case are both linked quite strongly. In fact, I published this paper just in October this year at a symposium arranged with regards to the particular trial embankment in Malaysia, the Muar trial embankment. I'm going to come back to that later. But this was published there. So this is available. The content of the webinar today is very much related to this paper. And of course, the paper can include a lot more detail than I can present in 1 hour. Now, why am I talking to you about site investigation of soft clays when perhaps if you know what I've been doing for the last 30 years, I've been working in the field of reinforced soil and stabilized soils using geosynthetic materials. But before that, I spent 2 extremely interesting years in Malaysia, where I helped to set up a testing laboratory called the Central Soils Laboratory, or CSL, we used to call it. And there is a rather nice picture of the staff in about 1989, I think. Anyhow, we use various techniques, pizza cone, vein testing, dilatometer. We use piston sampling techniques and laboratory testing, of course. And what was important here was that the main target was to investigate the marine clays that cover a lot of Malaysia and were a major issue, if you like, in the design of the North-South Expressway, which is a project that we were working on in those days. And apart from the testing itself and my experience at CSL, I was also involved in two trial embankments, the Moir trial embankment, which we'll talk about in detail later on, and another one, the Juru trial embankment. And these two also helped me to see very nicely the relationship between site investigation and then the later performance of structures over those materials. So it's a case of combining the two sets of experience. After about a year or so of working at CSL, there was an event organized to summarize a lot of the experience that had been obtained on the geotechnical engineering aspects of the North-South Expressway. And it was actually also put into a seminar. You can see the front of the book there. And there is a wealth of experience and knowledge summarized in that document. I'm quite sure you can't find that book any longer, but if anything interests you, then I can obviously help you with that. Now, let's move on to the first main topic, which is the marine clay profile. I have talked about this before, but I think it's an important starting point because the main soft clays of interest along the route of that particular project in Malaysia were the marine clays. And they covered around about 250 to 300 kilometers of the route. So they were a major significance to a project of that size. So marine clays, these are materials which are formed by the deposition of clay minerals on the seabed. That means, of course, that the sea level must be above the level of deposition. So an important piece of information when you consider this is the sea level record. Now, the graph there shows in the horizontal direction number of thousands of years ago, and in the vertical axis, it's the sea level relative to today. Today, we're at zero. And what you can see very clearly there is that the sea level has been changing a great deal. And because of this, if you have a marine clay where the current surface is quite close to ground level or above sea level, sorry, the ground level above sea level, then there are only two possible times when it could have been deposited. And they're indicated by the yellow stripe, which is normally referred to as the lower marine clay, and the red stripe, which is the upper marine clay. So they could only be deposited during what are called the interglacial periods. And we are currently in an interglacial. We call it the Holocene period, which is where the red bar is over on the left-hand side of that diagram. What you will also notice is that during that time, any area which today is a low-lying coastal area would have been far above sea level in most of that time period. And that's something else to be aware about when you look at this information. And I also want you just to note, I've shown there with a little triangular symbol when the famous Toba volcano erupted, because I'm going to briefly mention that again in a minute. It's something that crossed my mind when I was examining information to prepare this, and I think it's quite relevant. So we're going to look at the marine clay profile by examining what's called a DELF continuous sample. I was involved in taking this in Singapore at Norfolk Road. Quite a long time ago, and in fact, our ballasted CPT truck is right in the position there where it took the sample. And adjacent to the sample, we also have a pizza cone test, CPTU, which we'll talk about later, and also a vein borer test, again, which we'll talk about later on. So this image is something I've shown to people quite a few times, but the reason why I think it's quite helpful is that when you look at samples and testing from a marine clay profile, you normally see little bits and pieces, an isolated sample here, or you might see some material in a split spoon of an SPT or something like that, and fairly disturbed. But the nice thing here is that you see the full profile. And I just want to spend a few minutes explaining what we're seeing here. And I'm going to also relate it to an adjacent CPT cone test. So this is the cone resistance profile in megapascals. And of course, the vertical axis is the depth below ground level. So let's just look at the history. So starting at the bottom of the profile, that must have been deposited around about 125,000 years before present. If you look at the record on that previous sea level chart that I had. And then the lower part is called the lower marine clay, and it was deposited at the end of the Pleistocene. And what you'll see is I've made the cone resistance graph have a dark color to represent that part of the profile. So you can see very uniform on the cone resistance plot. But then above it, there's a sudden change. You can see that the cone resistance becomes very high. So in this part of the profile, now with a yellow box around it, this is what we normally refer to as the intermediate layer. Actually, it's the top of the lower marine clay when it became a land surface. Because the sea levels dropped a long way, that became a land surface, so it became subject to weathering, desiccation, and so on, which is why we see those mottled brown and light gray colors. That's the result of weathering. And that's a fairly stiff clay. You can see how the cone resistance has shot up because it's been affected by desiccation. But the next 1 meter is what particularly interests me, or it got my interest even more when I was looking carefully at this information, because is that 1 meter ash from the Toba volcano? Now, 1 meter is quite possible. The Toba volcano was not far away from Singapore. And this material is definitely not marine clay. You can see that the cone resistance is actually quite low. And from my memory of preparing that sample, the consistency of that material was nothing like the rest of the intermediate layer. But there it is. I would like to think it's the ash, which has become fairly weathered over the last 74,000 years. So it is gradually changing itself from an ash-like material into more of a clay-like material, or certainly a fine material. Just interesting, that could well be Toba ash. Above it, we have a buried topsoil layer, which is a little bit stiffer again, because that was the ground surface where things were growing for many tens of thousands of years before the sea level rose again, and we start to see deposition of what we call the upper marine clay. Now you can see at the bottom of that layer, we have lots of seashells because it was right by the sea edge, and you tend to get an accumulation of things like seashells and so on. But then as the sea rises further and the shore becomes further and further away, then there is less and less shell being deposited until we reach the top. So this was happening between 4,000 and 8,000 years before present. And then above that, we have some fill, recent deposits put there by humans. But I just think that this is a wonderful record to look at. So when you're looking at samples and small parts of the marine clay profile, what you see here is a very good kind of calibration of to remind you of what is actually what you're actually looking at in terms of the full profile. Now, when we start to talk about the information in a minute on site investigation in soft clays, it'll be principally the upper marine clay that we look at. So that's the left-hand side of the image. And we'll see much more about that as we go on. Now, clearly the upper marine clay is the youngest, it's generally the softest, it's the one that causes the most problem when we're building infrastructure in these areas. So an understanding of the upper marine clay is something of great importance. There is the full pizzocone result. I'm going to talk about pizzocone testing in a little bit more detail shortly, but you've got these various profiles. The cone resistance is now roughly in the middle. On the left side, we have the local friction plot, and then the red symbols are the vein test results that were carried out at the same location. It's very nice because they plot very nicely on the same axis values of kilopascals, but in terms of strength. Then as we go more onto the right hand side, we have the water pressure plot, which is an instantaneous water pressure developed as the cone penetrates into the soil. And then the well-known friction ratio is over on the right hand side. We'll learn a bit more about these profiles as we go along, but it's very nice to see how this compares to the actual sample which we looked at just now. So a little bit more about the marine clay profile. Now, there is a marine clay site. You know that because the buffalo is all covered in gray mud because he likes to sink into it and remind us about what's underneath this site. But that site is perhaps 1 or 2 meters above today's sea level. Now, if that's the case, then the sedimentation of the clay particles must have stopped around about 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. Now, in that situation, the clay is likely to be very lightly over-consolidated. We use this terminology. And that's an important point to realize about these clays. They are generally lightly over-consolidated. And in particular, it's unlikely to be under-consolidated. This can be an issue in these very young clays, but this one isn't quite so young because it's been there at least 3,000 to 4,000 years. In fact, when we looked at both the Moir trial embankment and another one called the Juru trial embankment, we had profiles of reference piezometers, and they both demonstrated in both cases that there was a perfectly hydrostatic existing pore pressure profile at those locations. Now, this might not be the case in an area of active deposition. So there's a rather nice picture of the Mahakam Delta, which of course is in Kalimantan in Indonesia. And in these areas under the current sea, we have active sedimentation of clay particles. In that case, the clay thickness is still growing. So in these situations, then the clays could well be under-consolidated, which means to say they have not yet reached a simple hydrostatic pore pressure condition. They will have excess pore pressures within their profile. Now, the reason I'd like to mention is that this graph is frequently quoted by people in papers and presentations. And what are we looking at here? Well, the horizontal axis is the rate of sedimentation of a deposit in millimeters per year. And the vertical axis is the average degree of consolidation, assuming a 15 meter thick deposit. This was originally published by Morgenstern quite a long time ago. And you can see how for different soil types, you get different relationships on this graph. And sometimes this graph is being used to suggest that these Holocene deposits may be under consolidated. And in fact, a further publication a little bit later by Cox in 1970, he adapted this diagram to the conditions of Southeast Asia, and he showed where the typical deltaic clays appear on this diagram, both, for example, in Thailand and also in Indonesia. But the point here is what this shows you, if you have a fairly high rate of sedimentation, then your degree of consolidation may be far from complete. But the important point to realize when you look at this diagram is only relevant to locations currently undergoing deposition. Because if they're not, then the rate of deposition is zero and you're way off the left-hand end of the diagram. So please be aware when you look at that particular relationship. When you're looking at marine clay, also, when you're looking at soft clay data in general, one of my first questions is always, what's the ground level? Now, if the ground level is currently, say, around about 2 to 3 meters above current sea level, then it can well be a marine clay. But if it's much higher than that, it's unlikely to be a marine origin because the sea never reached that level. Certainly in parts of Indonesia, if you go way inland in Sumatra, you'll have very soft clays, but you could be 10 to 12 meters above sea level. So they were clearly not marine clays. Is that important? Yes, it is, because there is significant difference in the effects of deposition under seawater and freshwater. Today, I have no time to go into that, but it is an important issue. So when we're now planning site investigation of soft clay sites, then generally we're going to be considering two main design cases. The first one is stability. So if we're going to build an embankment, we want to make sure it doesn't fail. And generally, this is a short-term problem. It may not be an instantaneous problem. You can get delayed failure due to migration of pore pressure, but it's relatively short-term. And when we look at this, we normally will use undrained total stress parameters, although you might want to use effective stress parameters if you're using FEA. That's another big topic, way beyond what I want to talk about today, but just to be aware of that. But today I'm going to concentrate on total stress undrained strength parameters. In fact, what was interesting, that this was the topic of a symposium on the Moir trial embankment back in 1989, and I'm going to come back to that at the end of this webinar. The other big problem is settlement of your fill. So this is a longer term problem, and we're going to be interested in compressibility and parameters related to compressibility. And this was also the topic of a symposium just this year, the one I mentioned my paper just now, also to do with the Moir trial embankment. When I say MTE, that's the Moir trial embankment. And we're going to come back again to that at the end of this event. So the presentation today is going to concentrate on parameters related to the settlement prediction, because that was the main topic of this symposium back in October this year. But much of it is also appropriate to the undrained stability case as well. So we're not leaving anything out of importance. Now, I thought I would, let me backpedal slightly. I gained most of my experience in investigating soft clays 30 years ago or more. In Singapore, it's more like 40 years ago. But is this still relevant today? From my experience of looking at site investigation reports and over the last 30 or so years, my opinion is it's highly relevant. So I've just made a simple tabulation here of techniques for carrying out site investigation over soft clays. So in this table, on the left column, we have the main investigation technique. The second column is possibly a secondary technique. And then I've awarded scores, if you like, to the ability to look at the situation of stability and settlement based on the data you're likely to get, and then a few comments. So my first type of investigation would be boreholes with SPTs and nothing else. Amazingly, people still do this today. And I've awarded our ability to assess both stability and settlement as one, which is very low. You might measure Atterberg limits and you might be able to get water content and unit weight, but that's about as far as you can go. We then have boreholes with open tube sampling and nothing else. Open tube sampling is not too bad, but not so good in soft clays. So you might get a bit more data from UU triaxial tests and maybe odometer tests, but there may be a fair bit of disturbance as well. So still not very high scores, 2 and 2 for both stability and settlement. What about boreholes with open tube sampling, but also some vein tests in the boreholes? This is quite common. So after taking a sample, then you put you lower a vein test piece of equipment down the borehole and you do a vein test. Certainly an improvement. So we might get a better set of data to investigate stability. So I've now given stability a 3, but we still are a bit short of really high quality data, especially for settlement. Now let's move on a bit to boreholes with piston tube sampling. Now this changes things quite a lot, because piston tube sampling is going to give you far better quality samples in soft clays. And if we combine that again with vein tests in the boreholes, we get an improvement in both areas. So I'm now awarding a level 4. In other words, pretty good in terms of both stability and settlement assessment. But there's one slight problem here. If you want to do your entire investigation with boreholes and piston sampling, it's going to be a very expensive and probably quite slow investigation. So you would like to find a way to speed it up. So what about the same approach, boreholes with piston sampling, but then we supplement this with both vane tests and CPTU or pizzocone carried out separately. And this immediately becomes far better. We get a lot more data. We get much better profiles of information from the vane borer and also, of course, from the pizzocone or CPTU test. So I've awarded a 5 to both stability and settlement in this case. But I still have one issue with this approach, because generally when people are planning this, they do boreholes as their primary investigation, and they fill in between it with CPT, between the boreholes. They don't go out of their way to correlate the two, not normally. So therefore, my last approach is like this. We switch the main technique to pizzocone, CPTU that is, and then we do boreholes and piston sampling with piston sampling, and also vane borer profiles at carefully selected locations adjacent to the pizzocone tests based on the data that we see. And this gives all sorts of advantages, a much faster investigation, but very carefully tailored sampling. Literally, you can decide on every sample depth by putting your borehole next to a pizzocone test. So I've awarded this 5+, excellent. We can also check correlations very nicely, because I think, as all geotechnical engineers know, we rely greatly on correlations to give us various parameters that we can't measure directly. And here we can actually do some checks on our correlations by using that kind of approach. So for me, that's the way I would like to tackle the problem of investigating soft clay sites. Just a few words about piston sampling. I'm not quite sure how well people know this and why it's an advantage, but just a simple little diagram here. I haven't got any pictures of a piston sampler, but there's a little cross-section of a borehole somewhere in a soft soil. And firstly, when you're doing a borehole in soft soils, you need to keep the casing right down the bottom of the borehole. And you normally need to keep the borehole full of water, maybe even a drilling mud to make it a bit heavier. But if we're going to take a sample, what happens? It's like this. So we lower the piston sampler down to the bottom of the borehole. And the reason why it's called a piston sampler is that it has a piston in the middle of the sampler, as you can see there. Having reached the bottom of the borehole, we then clamp the inner rod and therefore the piston at the drilling machine level so it can't move. And then, having done that, we then push the piston sampler down, but the piston itself doesn't move. Now, there is a valve involved in this to allow the water out, but then you pull the sample back out and the valve closes, so water can't enter again inside the sample tube. So the sample tends to come out with far better geometrical properties and much less disturbance. We also, for piston sampling, we normally use a very thin sampling tube. And it's important that the geometry of the sampling tube is carefully arranged. So normally, the entrance point of the sampling tube should have a very slightly smaller diameter than the tube itself. This is to allow the sample to enter easily and not get jammed inside the sampling tube. There are some fine details here, but it's something that in a big project, you would normally investigate this to find the best geometry for your piston sampling tubes. Also, things like packaging and transportation of piston sample tubes. So those three tubes you can see there in the picture are piston sample tubes, and they've been put into a foam rubber lined box, which is then put into a specially designed vehicle with a kind of floating carriage, because it had to be carried about 400 kilometers to the south in Malaysia to minimize the effect of bouncing around in the back of a truck. So we went to some quite big lengths to get good quality samples. Likewise, also when you extrude the samples, your extruder needs to be very good as well. Again, to minimize, because when you push on the sample, you're going to compress it. So you need to be very careful about extrusion as well. So I just want to look at a a case study where we used the techniques I've just described to investigate a section of the North-South Expressway in Malaysia. And the site could well have been this one. It probably was, actually, but there is the contract name. It's somewhere north of Penang, for those of you who know Malaysia reasonably well, north of Butterworth, in an area of marine clay. And the main site investigation over a particular length of the site of about 1 kilometer had consisted of 7 boreholes. And the highway was crossing a road and 2 large irrigation canals. And on the basis of that investigation, they decided to build a fairly long viaduct. Here is a simple cross section. So just to let you know that the horizontal axis is in kilometers. So that's 100 and 101. So the distance between those two numbers there is 1 kilometer. And the vertical axis, of course, is the elevation. And you can see that we are a short way above sea level in this particular location. So because there was an indication of soft clays, they decided to use a long viaduct. However, in carrying out a reassessment of this particular section, the client decided to carry out some additional site investigation. And we did 34 pizza cone tests, which gave us a very good and accurate profile of the soil types. And then on the basis of that, we did 8 boreholes and 13 vein test profiles, but with carefully determined locations for both the sampling and the vein tests. Let's have a look at it then. Here is a typical pizza cone profile. Now, some of you will be quite familiar with these, but it's the same as I described just now, those main profiles. So just to remind you, we have the depth axis, of course, going downwards. And then the diagram starting on the left are the local friction plot, then the cone resistance, the water pressure plot, and the friction ratio. Now, what you can see there is that the quality of the data is extremely detailed. So in one particular area, after you've done several of these tests, you start to recognize trends in the plots. And that very quickly allows you to build up a high quality profile of the soil types. So let's put that one onto our profile, just showing up the upper clay in blue, the lower clay in red, and then some sand layers, which were all identified very clearly in that particular profile. And then we add lots more of them. And then you can see it's very clear that we have a well-identified upper clay, which is interesting, the top of it is just above sea level, and also a fairly well-defined lower clay. And we can put some lines, if we like, along those boundaries. And we find that generally the clays are not particularly thick. Having done that, we then put down some boreholes and some vein tests, and we do some very detailed sampling and testing just within those clay layers. And then from that, we develop 2 profiles, one for the upper clay, the blue color, and one for the lower clay, the red color, where we get profiles here of things like Attleburg limits, undrained shear strength, pre-consolidation pressure, and compressibility. And from that, we were then able to make a far better assessment of the likely behavior of an embankment over those soils. And because of that, the viaduct was changed to 3 short span bridges. The additional cost of the SI in those days, about $100,000, and it saved about $2 million in construction costs. So it was certainly money well spent. So let's now move on to some more detail. I want to speak briefly about various parameters that we measure when we do this kind of site investigation. And I'll first of all talk about the physical and index properties. And these are if you get a site investigation report, these are normally tabulated, sometimes very extensive tables going on for page after page after page, where you get this kind of information. And here's just an example where we have one particular borehole and we have various properties there, things like water content, unit weight, then we have specific gravity, void ratio, porosity. Beyond that, we have the degree of saturation. And then beyond that, we have the Attleburg limits. And if they're presented in this way, they're really a bit difficult to kind of assemble into a picture. So what I always urge people to do is to plot profiles and relationships to understand this data more easily. And you will quickly turn this from a huge array of numbers into some very usable relationships. So let's have a look at this. And the subject I've chosen here is the site investigation from the Moir Trial Embankment, which was the subject of this symposium I mentioned back in October this year. And I've plotted there some profiles, which are very important ones to have a look at. But if we start on the left, everything's against depth from ground level. The first plot is the Atterberg limits and water content. And if you plot them in this way, where the Atterberg limits are a horizontal line with a plastic limit at the left end and the liquid limit at the right end, and then the water content is the symbol, in this case, a square symbol, it very quickly gives you a very nice image of what those profiles look like. The second profile is the plasticity index, which is the length of the horizontal line. But I've singled that out for a good reason, which we'll see in a minute. The third one is the unit weight. That's the bulk unit weight. Very important in when we're doing settlement calculations. So we need to know that accurately. Then I'll explain why that the fourth profile is actually from a pizza cone test. But I want to come back to that briefly in a minute. But I'll concentrate on the other properties first of all. So I have a bit of what I call conspiracy theory here, that maybe there's a problem with the liquid limit values, and maybe they're too low. So when you look at Atterberg limits, it's important to be aware of the method of preparation used, and this can affect the results. And that was my first suspicion. Whenever I've looked at those profiles, I've just wondered, why is there such a big gap, especially in the upper part of the profile between the liquid limit values and the water content? Normally that indicates a highly sensitive clay. These are quite sensitive, but I wouldn't say they're highly sensitive. So let's investigate what could have happened. Now, this is a big jump in the presented diagram. I'm showing you what we call a plasticity chart, where we plot plasticity index from some clay samples against liquid limit. But in this particular case, this was some research done by colleagues at CSL to investigate the method of preparation when you do an Atterberg limit test. Now you might say, well, what's that all about? Atterberg limit tests are carried out on the material finer than 425 microns, which is halfway up the sand range. Now, to make that separation, we use wet sieving, which means you end up essentially with a muddy slurry, and you've got to dry it. And when you dry it, you can normally either air dry it or oven dry it. But also, there is a very good argument. If you're absolutely sure that your clay's got no coarse material in it, why not just test it in its natural condition? So we use these three approaches on samples of marine clay, and the results are shown on the graph. So just if you take any set of the data, what you will find is that you have three results. The Atterberg limits determined from a natural preparation, in other words, without drying, then air dried with the brown symbol and oven dried with the red symbol. And what you can see is that the Atterberg limits are generally reducing as you go from natural to air dried to oven dried, because it has an effect on the clay mineral particles themselves. And that data is for marine soils. So if this is the situation, and the first thing just to mention is that when you look at Atterberg limit data, it's important to be aware of how the Atterberg limits samples were prepared, which you very rarely know. But you should find out, did this affect the data I've just shown you? So what I've decided to do here is to say I'm suspicious of those liquid limit values. So I'm going to also investigate the data where I simply make the liquid limit equal to the natural water content, which is what we normally see in the marine clay profiles that the many profiles I've seen over the years, that's normally the case. And this is important if we're going to use Behrum's correction factor for the vein shear strength. And we're going to see the effect of that shortly. So let's go back to this profile. And in the second profile from the left, plasticity index, I have now plotted another profile where I've simply assumed that the liquid limit is the same as the water content in each of those specimens that were tested. And you can see it significantly increases the value of PI, not surprisingly. Something else I want to talk about briefly is unit weight. Now, unit weight is incredibly important in settlement calculations. If you're doing calculations of stability with undrained shear strength, then the unit weight is not having an effect, but it is very important in settlement calculations, particularly because in these soft clays, the unit weight is not much higher than the unit weight of water. So how do you measure unit weight? Well, normally we do it by taking samples where we measure their dimensions and their weight, and we simply calculate the unit weight from that. But this diagram here shows the relationship between unit weight and water content, which is something we can take advantage of when we're looking at this data. Now, the first thing to mention is that if you plot unit weight versus water content, as I've done here, and you also plot a line indicating full saturation, which is the thick brown line, then if your samples have come from below the water table, then they should plot very close to that line. And you can see in this case that the majority of them are very close. So you're happy that your samples are fully saturated. And then there are one or two low dots, if you like, on that diagram, which may well have been affected by organic content, which will therefore result in a lower value of specific gravity. But sorry, now I want to get back to the other point I was making about the importance of unit weight, which actually, I'm sorry, is on the next slide. I was slightly ahead of myself then. So, as I said, we normally measure unit weight by taking a cylindrical sample and measuring its weight and dimensions. But that's sometimes difficult to do, and it may be rather disturbed. And it does require high quality samples, but there is another way of doing it, because if you know the water content and you've measured specific gravity, then you can calculate the unit weight from that relationship. And that's another way of checking unit weight if you haven't actually done it through specimens, test specimens. So it's quite helpful to be able to do this. And in fact, when I do this for the data I've just shown you, and we'll see on the next slide, we get remarkably good agreement. So if you look at the third profile from the left, the unit weight profile, there is now an additional line on there coming from the water content and specific gravity approach. And it does give us a verification very nicely of the unit weight values. So it's an independent check, quite independent. That's the nice thing about it. Now, one thing I just wanted, before I leave index properties, I just want to make a point about the CPT, because we're going to come to pizza cone testing and CPT in a minute. And they are extremely good tests to use in soft clays. They are excellent. But one thing I'd like to point out here is that the profile of cone resistance and water pressure, which is towards the right hand side of this profile, if we look at this green line, which separates an upper clay from the lower clay, this is where it says upper clay and lower clay, that's not the same as the upper marine clay and lower marine clay, which were determined by their age earlier on. It's just two parts of this same profile. It's all upper marine clay in terms of the geological aspect of it. But the point I want to make here is that there is a very big difference in performance and properties for the upper marine clay and the lower marine clay separated by that green line. Yet, if you look at the cone resistance data, the pizza cone data from both cone resistance and water pressure, you see almost no hint of a change. So this is why it's also really important to have some good quality sampling and testing of these sorts of soils to help supplement the data from CPT. So CPT by itself, great, but you do need to also carry out boreholes at some, and good quality sampling and testing. Actually, it's quite interesting that when you read the report about this deposit, there was an indication that maybe when the sea level reached the level of that green line, it dropped a bit, and for a short length of time, well, maybe quite a long time in reality, that surface became a ground surface again, subject to desiccation and so forth, before the sea level came back up again, all within the Holocene, and deposited the upper part of the profile. It's an interesting point, but there is a big difference in the behavior of the upper clay and the lower clay as we see them in that profile. So a few words about various test methods. I'm going to be quite quick here because this has been talked about before in some of these webinars, but the vein test, incredibly useful test. This is the vein that we push into the soil right from the ground surface. We normally call it a vein borer. You can see some nice clean looking veins that have never been used yet, plus some equipment on a site. And it's a very nice test method because the equipment is simple, it's very robust, and we can derive a very detailed profile of undrained shear strength from the vein test very quickly. So I think this is a particularly good test technique. The test is done by pushing the vein into the soil and turning it, and we rely on the shear that's created to give us the undrained shear strength. There is a standard test procedure where we first of all do a test called to measure the peak strength. We then essentially spin the vein round a bit and wait a bit. And then we do the second test, which is what we call the remolded strength. So we get peak strength and remolded strength from this in situ vein test. Just to show you some nice pictures of how it works. So there we have the unit set up on the site, and we can jack it down to a particular test level that we want to test at, like that. We then clamp the outer part of the equipment at the upper level. Having done that, we then push the vein out to the required test depth. We then put the torque measuring device on the top and we carry out the test. And I said, there are generally two vein sizes available, but in the upper marine clay, you'd always be using the larger vein to get the best sensitivity out of the test. Here's a typical profile of vein test results. This is from the Moir Trial Embankment site. Again, the vertical axis is depth, and we have two profiles. We have the peak, which is obviously the higher numbers, and the remolded, which are the lower values. And then the ratio of the two, we call that the sensitivity, and that's the right-hand profile. So normally I'd say, it's good to do this testing at once every meter. There's no reason why you shouldn't. Once you're set up, it doesn't take much longer to do that. But in this particular case, there were many of these profiles. So if we assemble them, all the profiles, there they are all together. And what we can then do perhaps is decide on some kind of design line or representative line of that data, which I put on there in a blue color. And then there may be some controversy over this, but if you're going to apply vein shear test data to either stability or settlement problems, then certainly my recommendation is you need to correct it, and the Beerum correction factor probably offers the best way to do it. So you might say, well, is this appropriate to Southeast Asian marine clays, something determined principally in Scandinavia? And the answer is, in my opinion, that you should do this, and we'll see why shortly. If you're going to, the Beerum correction factor on the vertical axis is related to the plasticity index, and that's why the PI is important when you do this. So I've there put a profile of the correction factor for the two cases that I looked at earlier on, which was the reported PI and the adjusted PI based on my assumption that maybe the liquid limits were too low. And if we do that, if we apply that to the blue line, then we get the two sets of data, the green dots using the adjusted PI and the red dots, the reported PI. And you can see, especially in the top part of the profile, it makes a significant difference to the vein, to the shear strength. These are now corrected shear strengths that we might be using in design. So we'll look shortly at the effects of that. Now, there's a very useful relationship that we can also apply in soft clays published by Professor Messery, where he relates undrained shear strength to the pre-consolidation pressure. And the constant that he has there is 0.22. Now, that relationship has been shown to be valid for a wide range of soft clays, and it certainly was appropriate in the Malaysian marine clay at the Juru site where I did some investigation many years ago. And we can rearrange that to give us the pre-consolidation pressure, because the pre-consolidation pressure is something we want to know for our settlement calculations. So we can get the pre-consolidation pressure from the vein shear strength after correcting it and then dividing by 0.22. And the pre-consolidation pressure I'll be coming back to shortly. Of course, we can also measure undrained shear strength in the triaxial test. Now, it's my experience that this is really quite difficult to get good results. You need extremely good sampling. And on the whole, I find that this data is less reliable than vein testing. Of course, you can specify the tests and you can carry them out, but you need to be very aware of procedures used. So I've added onto this plot now with the black cross symbols, some results of undrained shear strength from laboratory UU triaxial tests. And you can see that there is a fair amount of discrepancy compared to the vein test. We'll see the effect of that shortly. Now, a few words about compressibility and the odometer test. The odometer test should be well known to all geotechnical engineers. So they're just some nice pictures out of a catalog. Thank you, ELE, for that. There is the typical cross-section of the odometer. So we have a specimen inside a rigid steel ring. It's the brown color inside that diagram. And then we apply a load and we measure settlement. Today, I cannot go into the details of this test in any way, but it should be well known to people. But one thing I do want to mention though is the load procedure. Now, normally when we apply the load, we normally apply a load which where we double the previous one. So if we start at say 6.25 kilopascals, as you can see in that last point there, the next load will be double that, 12.5, then 25, 50, 100, and so on. That is the normal procedure, and it's called a load increment ratio of one. And I want to just come back to that in a second. Here is a very nice detailed result of a consolidation test. The upper diagram on the right is the famous E log P plot, where we plot the void ratio, or we plot the applied pressure against the void ratio. But we often see those diagrams in report, but the lower diagram is a summary of all the associated calculated results. Today, no time for details, but we got things like compressibility, the MV values, coefficient of consolidation. It's really important to see how they relate to the pressures in the test. And you can see, without knowing what the numbers are, there's a huge change halfway through that test. And the change comes around at the point that we call the pre-consolidation pressure. So what I'd like to mention here is that when you're looking at odometer tests, generally in the tabulations, you'll get three values, probably the pre-consolidation pressure, coefficient consolidation, and the compressibility, but there's lots more to the tests than that. So if you're assessing these tests, I strongly recommend you find the full result like this and examine everything. Just to answer a point about why do we like to use void ratio, not strain? Sometimes people will plot these diagrams against strain, but void ratio is a very nice parameter. And the reason I show it like this now, I've extended the void ratio axis down to -1. And this is just to show you the relevance of a void ratio of 3. Because if I now put a diagram beside there, the solids are represented by the void ratio below the 0 point down to -1. And the voids are represented by the blue area. And of course, in a saturated clay, they're full of water. So it makes a point. A void ratio of 3, your sample is mainly water. And that's, of course, why we get the incredibly high compressibility that we see in those deposits. Another point I'd like to make, which is about interpretation of the odometer. Here is, again, another one of these famous E log P plots. And the way we are told to interpret this, to find the pre-consolidation pressure, is like this. We draw a line, first of all, up the linear part of the graph there. We then try to determine the point of maximum curvature, which is not that easy, to be honest. We then put a construction on there, and we bisect that angle. And the point where that line meets the other line, just there, we determine to be the pre-consolidation pressure, which in this case is 250 kilopascals or thereabouts. It all looks great. And generally inside investigation reports, that's what the technicians will have done to provide the numbers. If I replot that graph, and of course I did it on purpose, if I replot that graph with a linear applied load scale in the horizontal direction, it's actually a perfectly straight line. There is no pre-consolidation pressure in that case. So the recommendation here is, if you're using odometer tests to give you the pre-consolidation pressure, then it's a very good idea to look at a linear plot on the pressure scale as well as the well-known log plot. Let's just look at a few results from the Moir trial embankment investigation. So there are some E log P plots. And if I then add to those plots across for the determined pre-consolidation pressure, you can see those black crosses that have arrived there. If you look carefully, you will see that essentially they are all at either 50 or 100 or 200 kilopascals, which are, of course, the loading stages. And what you tend to find is that quite often when the technician is interpreting this data, it's quite difficult. And they'll tend to go to the nearest loading stage below where they suspect PC dashed actually is. And they'll tend to report that. I know that by examining a lot of these results in my time in CSL. When I replot that data on a linear scale, and you see where the crosses are now, not quite so obvious you've got a pre-consolidation pressure identified, which requires a significant change in behavior. In fact, we investigated this by doing odometer tests with small uniform increments of pressure. And when you do that, you get a far better assessment of the pre-consolidation pressure. That was covered in a previous webinar. No time to go into more detail about that today. So if we now look at these profiles, I've now got profiles of the important parameters related to compressibility. So the left-hand plot is a diagram of stresses. I'll come back to that in a minute. What is PI and PF and so on, down on those, written down the bottom of those profiles. I'll come back to that diagram. I've also got the CC or compressibility value and the initial void ratio E naught, and then CC over 1 plus E naught, which is the parameter we're normally going to be using in our calculations. And I put a design line on there. Just a word of warning about some published correlations. On the CC plot there, I put the results of a well-known correlation to fine CC related to liquid limit. And you can see there seems to be a big difference. So be very careful when you're using published correlations. It's an extremely good idea to verify them. Now, a few words about pizza cone testing. Something I talked about also in a previous MRP webinar. But there is a nice image of a pizza cone. And let's just have a look at the details. So, of course, with a pizza cone, it's a form of CPT that we push into the ground. But it also has the benefit, apart from the normal cone resistance and local friction, it has a sensor to measure the instantaneous water pressure as you push it into the ground. So there is a diagram of it with all the dimensions on it. I don't need to read those through to you, but they're all standard. And you can see there the locations for measurement of cone resistance and local friction, and then also water pressure. The water pressure element can be located in different places, but the location I show there is the most common one. Just a point there that cones should be equipped with sensors to measure also inclination and temperature. So here is a very nice profile from a pizza cone test. I've already looked at this, similar profiles previously, but just a couple of points that I need to make about interpretation. When we interpret, we normally use some adjusted profiles. And when it comes to the cone resistance, we normally make an adjustment for the pore pressure or the water pressure on the back of the cone, which can only be measured using the pizza cone test. And then we would do our correlations from the lighter blue QT profile rather than the QC profile. And we'd also take into account the total overburden pressure in those correlations. Likewise, when we interpret from the water pressure plot, we normally take into account the hydrostatic background pressure in those correlations. There are alternative approaches to this, but these are the most common published ones that I'm familiar with. I want to mention very quickly three important points to do with pizza cone. And the first one is sensitivity. So in this diagram, I'm showing the cone resistance value in the horizontal direction versus the mean effective stress in a profile. And I've also shown the cone resistance on the bottom of this diagram as the load on the cone in kilograms. So you can see for different soil types, I've also shown their typical cone resistance values. So if we're in the marine clay, we're down at the very bottom end of the range where we're only measuring 10 or 20 or 30 kilograms on the cone. But these cones are also capable of measuring 1 ton or more. So you need to be aware that you are working at the very lowest end of the range. And for example, cone sensitivity is important. You can have cones of a higher sensitivity, which work in a lower range. And to be honest, for marine clays, it's by far the best thing to use those more sensitive cones. Another important point is about the effect of temperature. Those are three profiles of cone resistance against depth, where the only difference was the temperature of the cone at the time of preparation. And there is a parallel shift. And that parallel shift is not a soil property. It's all to do with the temperature of the cone when it was prepared for the test. And cones can be manufactured and they can be carefully instrumented to minimize that effect. That's certainly the case. But in my opinion, it's always a very good idea to make sure that you use procedures to minimize the effect of temperature in your CPTU tests. If I was to do this, I would be putting into my specification a requirement to carefully control temperature when you do the testing. Easily done, not a big issue, but well worthwhile. This is point number three, is all to do with the saturation of the filter. If you want to get a representative plot of water pressure, then the filter and the pore pressure measurement system must be extremely well de-aired. They should not have any air. They should be fully saturated. If there is air in the system, it makes the measurement system soft, which is the case in that brown profile of water pressure. What you'll also tend to notice, you'll get a very smooth profile, and you'll tend to get a little step every 1 meter, because that's the brief point in time when you stop penetration to add another rod in the test and you get a slight pause. When this was repeated, it looked like that. Even some slight issues at the top still, but that's a much better response. So this is all to do with good quality or good procedure in preparing the cones before you do the test. And then the last point I want to make briefly is about cone factors. We use cone factors to derive undrained shear strength from the cone resistance in a CPT. And you'll find lots of published values. You'll see people mentioning them in papers and articles and so on. But I just want to make you aware that there are all sorts of different ways they can be defined. And when you look at a particular value, please be aware of how the cone resistance, the cone factor was derived. So I've written down there, I'm not going to read through them, but there are four different possible ways of defining this NK, the cone factor, depending on the values you're measuring it. Is it the real undrained shear strength or the vein strength, et cetera, et cetera? Have you corrected the cone resistance for overburden pressure or not? And so on. And then also when we use the term NKT, that normally means it's been based on that corrected QC profile rather than the original one, the one taking into account water pressure on the back of the cone. So in fact, this the fifth one there is the one I've used on the graph over on the right, where the NKT value is between 18 and 19 in the upper marine clay. So please be aware of how cone factors were derived when you use them to interpret data. I have no full CPTU plots from the Moir trial data, but here are some typical examples. So we have their corrected cone resistance and pore pressure profiles, the light blue and the dark blue. And then from those, we can derive other profiles. And the derived profiles here are the AQ and BQ profiles. Now, what's nice about those profiles is that they can be related to the overconsolidation ratio, which in turn can give us the pre-consolidation pressure. There is a possibility these tests were done through the embankment. I'm not totally sure, but for illustration purposes, it doesn't really matter too much. So the A parameter is essentially a normalized cone resistance given by that relationship. And the BQ parameter is essentially the ratio of the increase in pore pressure to the cone resistance. And these can both be correlated with OCR. And in fact, if we go back to this diagram, the stress plot on the left-hand side is a profile where we have P dashed I, which is the initial effective stress in the ground, P dashed F, which is the final pressure due to building an embankment. We'll see that in a second. And then the red line is the pre-consolidation pressure based on vein testing. The crosses are based on odometer. And if I now add dots for interpretation based on the BQ value, they are the green square diagram. And you can see there's quite some variety. So the last thing I want to do now is to talk about the effect of assumptions on calculated settlement, because this is really what you're aiming at. When you do site investigation and you're going to want to derive parameters and carry out interpretations to allow you to calculate settlements of your embankment. And what I just want to show you is the effect of making some assumptions. To do this, I'm going to use the Moir trial embankment. I'm going to use the 3 meter control embankment, and it looks like this. So there is the profile of soils. We've been looking at the properties of those soils right the way through this presentation, but I've now shown you what it looks like with the embankment built on the top, all to scale, drawn to scale there. You've got the upper clay, taken to 6 meters thick, and the lower clay. I've divided it into 1 meter layers, and I've just done some very simple settlement calculations using a spreadsheet. And what I want to do now is to look at the effect of certain assumptions. So Here are two very important profiles. I've added there the compressibility profile, that's CC over 1 plus E naught, and also the unit weight profile. These are both very important to calculating settlement. So what I'm showing you now is what I call the basic case. In fact, it's the case which I think is most realistic. It's the basic case. And so to do my calculations, it works like this. Here is the pressure profile. So just to remind you, we have a profile called PI. That's the initial vertical effective stress in the soil profile. Then we build the embankment. That's the particular embankment I showed you. And after consolidation is complete, we'll reach P-F, the final pressure. And then the red line is the pre-consolidation pressure in the soil profile. And the way the calculations work is like this. So we start at PI, that's the initial pressure. And as the pressure increases and reaches the pre-consolidation pressure, we say that the soil is in the over-consolidated condition, and we calculate delta H over-consolidated using that well-known formula. I don't need to read through it. Once we pass the pre-consolidation pressure, oh, sorry, just to say I get 287 millimeters by doing that. Once we pass that pre-consolidation pressure, we then go into the normally consolidated behavior, and we're going to use the well-known relationship you see there based on logarithmic pressure, which happens to fit the data better. So that gives us delta H for the normally consolidated range, which is about 1.5 meters in this case. And then we add them together to get the total settlement. So that value of 1,825 millimeters, in my opinion, is the best estimate. And this calculation is only for primary consolidation. We don't have there the effect of the initial deformation of the soil due to undrained loading, and we also don't have the effect of any secondary compression. It's just the consolidation settlement. So what I want to do now is to look at the effect of changing assumptions. And the first ones I'm going to do are look at the unit weight profile and the compressibility profile. You can see them there as we had them previously. Now, if you're a Plaxis fan and you use those profiles, you've got to divide your soils into 1 meter layers, which you're going to find a bit of a nuisance. So is it okay if I smooth those profiles by taking averages, basically? Let's have a look. So we start off with the basic arrangement. We've already looked at that. What happens if I smooth the compression profile? And the answer is I get a very slightly smaller settlement, 1805. What happens if I smooth the unit weight by itself? I also get, in this case, a slightly higher settlement, 1836. What happens if I smooth both of them? And the answer is 1815, almost the same as the basic. So the good news here is by using thicker layers and smoothing the profiles of these values has not affected significantly the calculated settlement. So that is quite nice news. What about the water pressure, which is obviously given by the water level that you assume? Now, in the calculations, the water level was assumed at 0.5 of a meter below ground level, which was based on piezometer values. What happens if I tried 0 meters or 1 meter depth? Would that affect the results very much? Let's have a look. Here's the basic arrangement. If I now move the water level to 0 meters, I get a significantly, I'll do it, just watch how the pressure profiles move. You see, we get lower effective stress, which means that our over-consolidated part of the settlement is greater and the normally consolidated part is less. So we get a lower settlement prediction, 1761. And if I go to a 1 meter depth, then you can see how the pressure profiles move back to the right a bit, and I get a slightly higher prediction of settlement. So not a huge difference, but beginning to become significant. Then last thing is, what about the effect of my way I assess the pre-consolidation pressure. And I'm going to do this in a number of ways. I'm going to, first of all, base it on shear strength, which was my basic approach using the Mestre relationship. I'll then look at odometer test results and finally interpretation from CPTU. The rest of it will be as per my original diagram that you see there. So just to remind you, there's the basic arrangement again, where I corrected my vein test results based on my adjusted PI values. What happens if I used the PI values from the report to correct Beerum? To get my Beerum factors? If I do that, quite surprisingly, my predicted settlement is 200 millimeters less, which is becoming significant. If I decide, oh, I don't believe in Beerum's factors, I'm just going to ignore it, I'm not going to correct them at all, then I get only 1402 millimeters, which is, I can assure you, far too small. So this convinces me that correcting vein shear strength is important in these profiles. You can see how much the PC profile has now moved to the right by doing that. What about using odometer test results? Not too bad, but I get a slightly low prediction from the odometer test results. And what about using the UU triaxial test, which, if you remember, they had a rather strange distribution? If I do that, I only predict just over 1 meter, which I can assure you is far from correct. What about if I use BQ from the pizza cone test? Because I'm a bit suspicious of that profile, and it almost makes my entire profile normally consolidated, I don't think it's actually right. However, if I did do that, I would predict more than 2 meters. So what you'll have noticed there in the delta HC values is a significant range of results. So if I just put this into a nice little histogram, where the green is the normally consolidated part of the settlement, the brown is the overconsolidated part, settlement on the vertical axis, and then with a kind of abbreviated name, I got all those different approaches I've used. What you will need, of course, my target, the one I think is correct, is basic, which is towards the right hand end, fourth from the right. But what's really interesting here is that there is a 1 meter difference between the extremes. So if you then said, well, but these extremes really were extreme, we just would never do that. Even between the next ones, it's a half a meter range, and that's quite a big difference in the calculated amounts of settlement. So just a summary then of remarks, then what I'd like to say then about the investigation of soft clay sites is like this, that with good planning and execution, we can get really good results from an investigation of these soft soils. I would recommend you make maximum use of in-situ testing, especially pizza cone, that's CPTU, and the vein borer, both excellent tools. Just a point here, I never mentioned the Sondera mechanical CPT, which we see use a great deal in Indonesia. Yeah, they are okay, but to get good data, they need to be really well executed. But just to make this point, you still need to do some high quality sampling and laboratory testing. You really need that if you're going to get a good result. It's vital. Obviously, attention to details and procedure is really important. And measurement of undrained shear strength, extremely important. In my experience, that's generally not done very well in many site investigation reports, which I see. And also, of course, determination of the pre-consolidation pressure. I've just spent some time explaining to you why that's very important. And one thing I think is also quite important is to try to use more than one approach when you're determining some of these important parameters. So that's kind of brought me to the end, but I better just ask this is the end of the main presentation, but I just want to ask the organizers if I can go on for another 10 minutes, or is that going to be too long? Hope someone will tell me.
Yes, Pak Mike.
Yes. Okay, right. Well, I'll try and be as quick as I can. I realize time is moving on, but I want to share something with you, which I think is quite remarkable. So not quite finished. And I'd like to spend a few minutes telling you about this incredible piece of investigation called the Moir Trial Embankment. I've been mentioning it all the way through, MTE for short, built in 1988. And it was done to help. It was basically part of the site investigation for the North-South Expressway, which was built up the peninsula of Malaysia from the very south to the very north. You can see a lovely aerial view at the time of construction of these trials. I'll tell you a little bit about it. But first of all, there was a symposium held in 1989 about the trial, and another one was held just in October this year. And what this has given is an incredible record from the early knowledge from that investigation right through to what, about 33 years later. Here's an outline or a plan of the trial. Now, when we look down on it, you can see that similar shaped as per the aerial photograph just now. And those are all different zones of different kinds of ground treatment. I don't want to talk about that now. It's a whole long discussion all by itself. But just to mention this, that there's a little embankment over there on the left, and that was the major interest in 1989 when that embankment was built to failure and there was a competition to predict the failure height. If you want to know more, get hold of the proceedings. It's a very interesting piece of work. The major interest in the recent work, that's this year in October, was the two control embankments, which are called schemes 3-2 and 6-6, which I've ringed there. And the interest here was what was the settlement? And there was a competition arranged to predict the settlement of those two embankments after 33 years. This is the committee that helped create this event. And they worked really hard. There was something like 44 committee meetings to do it. It was interrupted by COVID. It was going to be a 30-year anniversary, but because of COVID, it became almost 33 years. But I would like to recognize the incredible work done by this gentleman. I've just singled him out there. I'm going to make it a bit bigger. Engineer Yi-Chien Seng, who I've known ever since the beginning of this whole exercise. And it was really his incredible passion for this trial that made it happen. And he's hoping to preserve that embankment so that future generations of young engineers can benefit from the information that's come from it. It's still there today, hoping it's going to be retained for a lot longer yet. Very briefly, a few words about what happened. When you build an embankment on soft clay, it works like this. If you could build the embankment instantaneously by helicopter, like that, you would get an instantaneous distortion of the clay. Now, assuming it's saturated, there would be no volume change. It would be a distortion. Quite difficult to assess that, but that would be the first part of the settlement. Then, with time, you would get consolidation settlement taking place. So I'm rushing through these slides a bit, but consolidation settlement would come from expulsion of water. And that could take a long time. And in fact, that was really part of the big interest of the trial. And theoretically, that the consolidation ceases when the excess pore pressures have become zero, but that's very difficult to know. Beyond that, there will be further settlement due to what we call creep or secondary compression. And that can go on, well, it'll go on forever, but it becomes very, very slow, especially in a mineral clay, and it's time dependent. In fact, in my calculations just now, I was only looking at the consolidation settlement, but people were asked to predict settlement of the whole embankment. Let's show you what a real embankment looks like when you load it. So this is in scheme number 3-2. We're looking here at the fill thickness against the number of days in the horizontal axis. And you can see how it was built up in a number of stages, and it reached a total thickness of just under 4 meters. The target height was 3 meters above the original ground level. So it was called the 3-meter control. And that's the settlement record. So that settlement going vertically downwards, you can see measured in meters there, going up to around about day 1,300. Then at this particular point in time, day 602, an additional marker was placed on the center line of the embankment because it was then finished. And that marker called SM5 in green was then also monitored, giving the green result. Now, the challenge that was given to people to predict in the recent symposium in October was how much had that settled, that point, SM5, what was the settlement of that point on the 30th of June, 2022, which is approximately 33 years later. That's an incredible challenge to take on. It's even more incredible when I change the time scale to include today. So this is the same graph as I've just shown you, except that the time scale now goes up, you can see, to some very large numbers of days. And the thick blue dotted line is the 30th of June, 2022. So that was the target. How much settlement of SM5 had taken place by the time we reached that blue line? That was from Scheme 3.2. And without going through the whole description, we have the same information for Scheme 6.6, which was called the 6-meter control, although the fill thickness was almost, say, 8 meters. There was a bit of a discussion here about was the embankment becoming thinner, because the fill axis there is thickness. But other records suggest it probably wasn't the case. But anyhow, let's not worry about that too much. So again, the predictors for this symposium were asked to predict that behavior. They were given those above records that you've just seen, in digital form, plus all the site investigation data that I've been talking to you about in this this webinar today, and they were asked to make those predictions. These are all published papers. You can get hold of them if you wish. There were four predictions by well-known people. This table, I'm not going to read through it, but it simply summarizes their approaches, plus the settlements at the center of the two embankments, 3.2 and 6.6. And those numbers are in meters. And if I add the actual results, then for Scheme 3.2, it was 1.37 meters. And for 6.6, it was 2.34 meters. What you can see there is that, in fact, the predictions were generally significantly on the low side. So it just makes a point about how difficult it is to get this right. So if I go to this diagram for Scheme 3.2, the predictions are the blue bars and the actual is the red, thick red bar. And this is the same for Scheme 6.6. In fact, the closest to this was one of our colleagues here in Indonesia, Paulus Raharjo, and he actually made predictions in several ways. And one of his predictions was very close to the right one, but he decided to vote for one that was not quite so close. But I think it's an amazing piece of work. And for anybody involved in the design of embankments over soft soils, this is information you should study and learn from. So just my final remarks, I'm sorry I went on for a bit longer there, but those results I've just shown you, without a doubt, they emphasize the difficulty in making predictions of this type. No one's going to pretend it's easy. The starting point is always an excellent site investigation, of course. Plus, of course, some appropriate interpretation. I perhaps be a bit critical here, but I know that, especially if we're using certain software, we're very keen to get in there and start putting in numbers quickly and getting out some results. But it's important to spend plenty of time preparing for that, assessing your properties and parameters that you're using before you make that final big jump and do some calculations. So I hope this presentation has helped you to understand why that's quite difficult. But if done well, it's perfectly possible to get extremely good results. So thank you very much. I'm sorry I've gone quite a bit over time. I thought I would, but I hope that's given you a fairly good summary of the importance of the techniques used to investigate soft clays and the effects of your decisions and interpretations on the results you're likely to get in terms principally of settlement, but it would also be related to stability calculations as well. Thank you very much.
Terima kasih kepada Bapak Michael Dobie atas paparan menariknya. Sambil memberikan waktu kepada Bapak Michael Dobie untuk membaca pertanyaan yang sudah masuk, sekaligus menunggu pertanyaan lainnya, saya ingatkan kembali kepada Anda yang memiliki pertanyaan dapat langsung disampaikan melalui fitur Q&A yang terletak di bawah layar Anda. Pertanyaan dipersilakan untuk disampaikan dalam bahasa Inggris. Kami mengajak hadirin semua yang hadir di sini untuk mengikuti berita dan informasi terkini seputar PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria dengan follow dan like media sosial kami, follow Instagram kami di @multibangunpatria, Twitter kami di @multibangunrp, Facebook dan LinkedIn kami dengan nama PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria. Kami juga hadir di TikTok dengan username @multibangunpatria. Baiklah, Bapak Mike, apakah sudah siap untuk membacakan Q&A? Silakan, Pak.
Okay. Terima kasih, Astri, for your words there. We have a few questions here, and I'll do my best to answer these for you. So from Pak Hanif, it's a very good one, this one. Actually, this is a really important point. Have you a problem when you extrude the soft soil sample? Yeah, this I didn't mention the importance of extrusion. You know, if you've done all that work to get a sample into your sample tube and transport it to your laboratory, you don't want to damage it by extrusion. And certainly there are good ways and bad ways of doing it. Some sampling techniques make it very easy to extrude samples, like the Delft Continuous Sampler I showed you earlier on. In fact, the Delft Continuous Sampler is something that does make such good samples that they are almost without any disturbance. But the sad thing is that it's not a technique used very commonly. But with a good extruder and good procedures, you can minimize disturbance. One thing I would say with the piston sample tubes, when you extrude them, you've got to extrude them backwards. In other words, out of the top, because a piston sample tube will have the entrance diameter slightly less than the diameter of the rest of the tube. The purpose of doing that is because when you sample and you relieve stress, the samples like to expand slightly. And if you don't have a smaller entrance diameter compared to the tube, the sample's likely to get stuck or be severely compressed as you push it. But what we normally do with piston sampling is to push it back out at the top of the tube. So you don't push it through the entrance point with the smaller diameter. I think people often do it the other way around. But that's a slightly important point. If the sample is fully saturated, then generally, because extrusion should be done reasonably, not at very high speed, but reasonably quickly, it's very unlikely you'll cause any significant compression, because if the sample is fully saturated, it's virtually incompressible in the short term. So you probably won't damage it too much by extrusion, but it's important to avoid going out through the entrance diameter. Pak Nozaman from Multibangun, he said, oh, thank you very much for your comment there. And someone has also noted that this does open our minds to the importance of proper testing as an important part of any analytical design that we might carry out, not only in soft soils, but of course in any situation in geotechnical engineering. Then, oh, another nice question. So again, from Pahanif, how do you determine the NKT and the NK values? As we know, every location has different values. What is your consideration? Very good question. It's a point that you could spend a lot of time learning about. I have published a few papers about this. It would be my, if you have a big project, then I would definitely carry out some side-by-side CPT, preferably CPTU, and vein test. And also you need to have boreholes as well, because you really need to interpret your vein test data to give you the corrected undrained shear strength. So you need to know plasticity index. Now, my approach would be, certainly for a big project, I would do some local correlations and just see, first of all, did they seem to match up with well-established published correlations, or were they quite different? And if they were quite different, could I find an explanation why? There's plenty of published correlations available in all sorts of published papers and guidebooks on CPTU and so forth, but you might see NK values varying anywhere from around about 10 to over 20. One of the reasons for that variation is the way the NK or NKT value was derived. And that was the point of a slide I showed quite briefly just now, explaining how you could calculate an NKT or an NK value using different approaches. What's important is that the approach you use needs to be consistent with the approach used by the researcher or the person publishing a paper. However, the difficulty that I find is that in most published papers, we don't often find out exactly how they did it. We do in some papers, we know very well. But in many cases, people will say, the NKT or the NK value in this case was 13. And you have to say to yourself, well, but is that based on vein shear strength or the interpreted shear strength? Was the cone resistance corrected for the overburden pressure or not? Was it QT or QC? They all make a big difference. So it is quite what we say in English, a can of worms. And sometimes we're not sure, but an excellent question. From Pat Bagus, we heard from him just, different Pat Bagus, right. Excuse me, can you explain about extrude and undisturbed soil, how we get without Shelby tube, and Etterberg classification, soft clay treatment, expansion of soil? Yeah, Shelby tubes. I'm not keen on Shelby tubes. Shelby tube is what we call an open drive sampler. It doesn't have that benefit of the piston sampler. However, if you're careful with them, you will get some reasonable samples. Sometimes they tend to drop out of the tube with very soft clays, but the Shelby tube can work. I think generally with Shelby tubes, the level of disturbance is going to be quite a lot more than piston sampling. If at all possible, I'm not that familiar in Indonesia whether or not people are making a lot of use of piston sampling. It's a bit more equipment involved and it takes a little bit longer, but the benefits on the quality of the sample are very great. So as I mentioned earlier on, it would always be my recommendation for soft soil sites to use maximum or make maximum use of in situ testing like CPTU and so forth, and then take a relatively small number of high quality samples. And then another question here from Priscilla. Thank you for making the presentation. To ask about negative skin friction that would happen when you. Well, I think this is negative skin friction to do with pile design, I'm assuming. And certainly, it's not an area we've been talking about today, so I think I can't really give much of an answer except to say that the kind of data that I've been talking about today would help you make an assessment about the likelihood and the quantity of negative skin friction that could happen if you drive a pile through a soft soil into a firm foundation, and then the soft soil settles a bit due to application of, say, a fill. So yeah, the information should help you, but I'm afraid more than that, I can't really answer today. Thank you, Richard, for your comment there, and also another Pat Bagus. And Richard, does skin friction play a role in CPT data analysis? Oh yeah, well, of course, when we carry out CPT, we measure skin friction on the friction sleeve. So it is an element of the properties that we actually measure. But Bagus again, does the sample transport process? Oh yes, very much so. If you have samples with a void ratio of 3, so the sample is mainly water, and you let it bump up and down in the back of a truck, then you must expect disturbance to take place. So care in transportation of samples, extremely important. And then I think probably the last one I should answer is from Richard Ong from Malaysia. Richard was one of the committee members who was involved in this recent symposium. He just says, thank you very much for your comment, Richard. He listened to it before. He's also been talking there about the sensitivity analysis for the settlement calculation. Determination because impression most important. Yeah, actually I would. So when it comes to the main parameters that you use in a settlement calculation, as I've just done, another consolidation settlement, all the parameters are important without a doubt. But I think what you saw just now, and certainly the experience I have, is that it's the pre-consolidation pressure that is going to have the biggest influence on the results. A slight error in the unit weight, slight error in the water table level, I showed you just now, they have some influence, but not too bad. But a big error in the pre-consolidation pressure could have a huge effect. So yes, I think for me, and I think has been mentioned by many other people in the past, including Professor Messery, that the pre-consolidation pressure is the most important parameter to get right when you're investigating soft soils and carrying out calculations of that type. So I think I'm now well over time. There is another question down here, prove soil. Sorry, about peat soil. I didn't talk about peat today, so I won't be able to talk about that. I organized another webinar. You in Ghana. Good heavens. Well, you have to talk to me about that one. Yes, it's possible, isn't it? Okay, so I will bring that to an end now. I'm sorry, we're quite well over time, and I know that Multibangun have some more things to do, so I need to bring my contribution to an end. I'm sorry I've gone way over time, but there was a lot of material today. I knew that, but I'm today.
Pak Mike, terima kasih sekali lagi atas waktu, paparan, dan jawaban yang diberikan. Pada hadirin sekalian, kita akan beralih ke sesi selanjutnya, yaitu kuis berhadiah. Kuis berhadiah ini akan dipandu oleh Bapak Tri. Pada Bapak Tri, dipersilakan.
Oke, terima kasih Astri. Selamat siang Bapak Ibu sekalian. Perkenalkan, nama saya Tristio Harto yang akan memandu acara games kali ini. Games kali ini berhadiah total Rp600.000 berupa e-money ya Bapak Ibu ya. Pemenang pertama mendapatkan Rp250.000, pemenang kedua mendapatkan Rp200.000, dan pemenang ketiga mendapatkan Rp150.000. Dan 10 pemenang dengan poin tertinggi mendapatkan kalender eksklusif ya Bapak Ibu. Untuk e-money-nya seperti ini Bapak Ibu. Limited edition. Seperti ini. Dan kalender eksklusifnya seperti ini Bapak Ibu. Untuk pemenang e-money otomatis sudah mendapatkan kalender eksklusif juga ya Bapak Ibu. Karena kan dia 3 poin tertinggi. Gitu. Nah, untuk mengikuti acara games kali ini, Bapak Ibu cukup membuka browser Bapak Ibu, lalu masuk ke menti.com, menti.com, buka browser Bapak Ibu, lalu masuk ke menti.com. Nah, masukkan kode 2467-6003. Oke, Bapak Ibu, buka browser, masuk ke menti.com, lalu masukkan kodenya 2467-6003. Ya, Bapak Ibu, masukkan nama Bapak Ibu sesuai dengan yang diregistrasikan pada webinar kali ini. Karena hal ini penting kalau Bapak Ibu menang, panitia juga mudah menghubungi Bapak Ibu. Jangan ditulis asal-asalan, Bapak Ibu. Tulis nama sesuai dengan nama yang diregistrasikan pada webinar kali ini. Oke, sambil menunggu yang lain, Bapak Ibu buka browser, masuk menti.com, masukkan kodenya 2467-6003. Lalu masukkan nama Bapak Ibu ya sesuai dengan yang diregistrasikan pada webinar kali ini. Oke, sambil menunggu yang lain, ayo Bapak Ibu, e-money eksklusif limited edition serta kalender eksklusif nih Bapak Ibu. Ini ada goodie bag-nya juga nih Bapak Ibu nih. Yang saya pegang goodie bag-nya memang belum ini. Nanti dapat sama goodie bag-nya juga. Oke Bapak Ibu. 5 4 3, 2, 1 ya. Jawab dengan cepat dan benar ya Bapak Ibu ya. Oke, soal pertama. Which is the best sampling method for soft soil? Yang pertama, stationary piston sampler. Yang kedua, SPT split spoon sampler. Yang ketiga, open drive tube sampler. Jawab dengan cepat dan benar Bapak Ibu. Harus cepat, tapi benar. Bapak Ibu. Yang nyimak pasti gampang nih. Kalau nggak nyimak, langsung tembak jawaban aja Bapak Ibu. Oke. Stationary piston sampler atau SPT split spoon sampler atau open drive tube sampler. Ayo Bapak Ibu. Jawab dengan cepat dan benar. Kalau lama benar juga salah. Oke, 3, 2, 1. Jawabannya adalah yang pertama, Bapak Ibu, stationary piston sampler. Oke, kita lihat poin tertinggi dipegang oleh, ayo siapa ini? Ya, Bapak Jimmy. Pertahankan Pak Jimmy ya. Lanjut ke pertanyaan kedua. Lanjut ke pertanyaan kedua. Lihat layar, which is the best in situ test method for soft soil? Ayo Bapak Ibu, yang pertama standard penetration test atau SPT, yang kedua mechanical CPT atau sondir, yang ketiga piezocon atau CPTU. CPTU. Ayo Bapak Ibu, jawab dengan cepat dan benar. Standard penetration test atau mechanical CPT atau sondir, yang ketiga piezocon CPTU. Jawab dengan cepat dan benar. Benar tapi lama Bapak Ibu, poinnya pasti rendah. Gimana nih Bapak Ibu? Lumayan. Oke, jawaban yang benar adalah yang ketiga ya Bapak Ibu, piezocon atau CPTU. Oke, kita lihat leaderboard-nya siapa yang tertinggi. Oke, masih dipegang oleh Bapak Jimmy. Bapak Jimmy pertahankan. Kita lanjut pertanyaan ketiga, jawab dengan cepat dan benar. Which is the best way to measure compressibility of soft soils? Yang pertama, correlate with liquid limit atau LL. Yang kedua, correlated to CPT cone resistance. Yang ketiga, laboratory odometer test. Ayo Bapak Ibu, cepat dan benar. Yang nyimak pasti tahu, yang nggak nyimak tembak aja ya. Ayo Bapak Ibu, langsung jawabannya. Pencet, jawab dengan cepat dan benar. Correlated with liquid LL, atau yang kedua, atau yang ketiga, laboratory odometer test. Ayo, jangan banyak mikir Bapak Ibu, langsung jawab. Nah, 3, 2, 1. Jawabannya adalah, ya, laboratory odometer test. Yang ketiga ya Bapak Ibu. Nah, ini pemenangnya nih Bapak Ibu. Kita lihat. Siapa poin tertinggi nih? Oke, Bapak Roski. Ibu Roski atau Bapak Roski nih? Oke, Bapak Roski ya. Hey Grants. Oke. Selamat untuk Bapak Roski. Untuk para pemenang lainnya 10 poin tertinggi silakan klaim ke Ibu Riva ya nanti ya. Terima kasih untuk Bapak Ibu atas partisipasinya dalam acara games kali ini. Saya serahkan kembali ke Ibu Astri.
Baiklah, terima kasih kepada Bapak Tri yang sudah memandu acara games berhadiah pada pagi hari ini. Dan selamat kepada pemenang. Bagi yang belum berkesempatan untuk menang, masih ada hadiah e-money dan kalender eksklusif dari Multibangun Rekatama Patria. Caranya mudah sekali. Tinggal kunjungi Instagram kami di @multibangunrekatamapatria, temukan postingan giveaway MRP terbaru, ikuti instruksinya, dan semoga Anda yang akan menjadi pemenangnya. Dengan berakhirnya games tadi, maka sudah sampailah kita di penghujung acara. Untuk informasi mengenai sertifikat dapat diakses melalui link bit.ly/mrpweb12 yang juga tertera pada kolom chat, juga tertera pada layar Anda. Apabila Anda memiliki pertanyaan atau terdapat kesalahan penulisan nama pada sertifikat Anda, silakan hubungi Riva melalui WhatsApp di nomor 0822-9851-0700. Untuk informasi lebih lanjut terkait PT Multibangun Rekatama Patria dan acara-acara kami selanjutnya, silakan ikuti media sosial kami dengan follow Instagram kami di @multibangunrekatamapatria. Akhir kata, kami ucapkan terima kasih kepada seluruh peserta, pembicara, dan panitia yang terlibat dalam acara hari ini. Kami juga memohon maaf jika terdapat kesalahan dan perbuatan selama acara berlangsung. Sampai jumpa, stay healthy, selamat siang. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Halo Sobat Multibangun, kali ini kita akan membahas hal-hal yang harus diperhatikan saat membangun multi-block rekening system.
Yang pertama, tanah dasar harus kuat menahan beban di atasnya. Yang kedua, menentukan jenis material timbunannya. Menggunakan tanah merah, atau tanah bergumpir, atau granular. Tidak boleh menggunakan tanah yang bermasalah seperti expansive soil, soft soil, dan organic soil. Dan yang terakhir adalah mendesain panjang dan kekuatan geogrid yang dibutuhkan. Sekarang Sobat Mimpi Bangun sudah tahu kan? Sampai bertemu di video berikutnya!
Cerita hari pertama proyek. Duh, kira-kira bakal gimana ya? Aman, siap-siap.
Nah, udah siap banget nih gua kerja di proyek.
Iya, Mas, begitu. Nih, iya, kenalin, ada anak baru nih. Loh, Denny, kamu nggak pakai helm?
Oh iya, Pak. Saya ambil, Pak. Aduh, yang mana nih? Warnanya banyak lagi. Yang mana sih?
Hey, Denny, ayo buruan sini.
Ya, Pak, siap.
Eh, gimana, Denny? Udah pakai helmnya lo? Kok pakai itu?
Ya, Pak, siap.
Perjalanan membawamu bertemu denganku, ku bertemu kamu. Seperti
halo Sobat Mimpi Bangun, pada video kali ini kita akan bahas cara menimbun tanah di lahan yang berbeda. Pada kondisi normal, untuk menimbun tanah dibutuhkan kemiringan lereng yang lebih landai dari 45 derajat. Nah, pada lahan yang sempit, kira-kira bagaimana ya cara kita menimbun tanah dengan aman supaya tidak longsor? Cara yang pertama, jika area timbunan tanah sangat sempit sehingga lereng timbunan harus dengan lurus, maka kita bisa menggunakan multi-block retaining wall system. Begini nih cara pasangnya. Cara kedua, jika area timbunan tanah masih ada ruang untuk membuat kemiringan lereng, maka kita bisa menggunakan terusan waveform system. Untuk pemasangannya begini nih. Untuk lebih jelasnya, bisa kunjungi website dan media sosial kami ya. Sampai jumpa!
There once was a ship that put to sea, and the name of the ship was the Billy O.T. The winds blew harder, bowed it down below, my bully boys blow. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
Halo Sobat Mimpi Bangun, di video kali ini kita akan bahas step by step pemasangan multi-block retaining wall system. Yang pertama, kita lakukan pembersihan lahan atau land clearing. Yang kedua, dilakukan pemadatan lahan atau tanah dasar. Selanjutnya, pembuatan leveling pad atau lantai kerja. Selanjutnya, kita lakukan pemasangan blok beton yang pertama. Setelah itu, pemasangan lapisan pertama tensar RE geogrid dan konifernya. Yang ini penggelaran tensar RE geogrid. Kemudian, pemasangan batu pecah dan kiln tekstil sebagai drainase vertikal. Nah, semua tahapan tadi diulang terus hingga mendapatkan ketinggian yang diinginkan. Nah, jadi deh multi-block retaining wall systemnya. Gimana? Udah paham kan cara pemasangan multi-block retaining wall system? Sampai jumpa di video selanjutnya.
Sometimes I look in her eyes, and that's where I find.